Hey everyone, I'm Zach Armstrong with LabCoatz, and today we're building a real solid-state Tesla coil and even giving away a few of his PCBs. Let's go. Do you ever get tired of seeing the same old Slayer Accelerator demo videos on YouTube? Wouldn't you rather build something like this? What about this? And this? What if I told you could have all this in one circuit that you can custom build at home for possibly under 50 bucks? Sounds crazy, right? Well, you can.
You all loved my last Tesla coil video, so I'm back at in this video with an even more awesome circuit that leaves my simple SSTC in the dust. This one has it all. It's solid state, interrupted, makes sparks over a foot long, and is ran by an adaptable PCB that works for almost any coil. And unlike the old circuit, this one can be run for long periods of time without issue. No pesky ballast required. Best of all, this bad boy is also musical.
Now, obviously building a device like this is a huge undertaking, especially for someone like me with minimal experience working on such devices.
That's why I'm teaming up with several other high voltage enthusiasts and experts from around YouTube to make this video. I've spoken with Ryan from Magneticist, PowerMax, Brian from Psy2HD, and Jerry from Archangel, who has actually worked on Tesla coils with Steve Ward himself. For those who don't know, Steve Ward is kind of a big deal in the world of modern Tesla coils. Nick from Coil Labs is also joining us for the first time, along with our old friend, Clayton from the Plasma Prince.
Alright, let's have a look at the new circuit so we have a better idea of what we're dealing with.
I'm basing my circuit on the SSTC2 designed by Gao over at loneoceans.com. I chose his design as a template for mine because it was easy to replicate and also produces decently large sparks. Plus, the designs are really well documented on his website. That said, I did end up making a few modifications to optimize the original design. For one, I swapped out the microcontroller-based interrupter with a more traditional 555 timer circuit, as it is far more user-friendly and doesn't require programming. I additionally changed and removed a few other components, including the undervoltage protection part of the circuit, after I found it was causing more harm than good. Also, to make assembling this coil easier and less error-prone, I designed a compact PCB for it using the free EasyEDA online editor. I ordered the PCBs from jlcpcb.com, but I might have gotten a few extras. Stick around to the end of the video to see how you can get one. The driver for this coil works by first extracting a crude feedback signal from an antenna near the coil and passing it by a two-diode array. As PowerMax demonstrated to me over a Zoom call, these two diodes essentially lock the positive and negative voltage peaks of the AC signal to a set value, preventing dangerously high voltages from entering the sensitive driver circuit. Next, the signal passes through a resistor, capacitor, and 74HC14 Schmidt trigger, which converts a somewhat sloppy signal into a more functional square wave that matches the resonant frequency. The new square wave signal is then pumped into the UCC27425 gate driver IC, where it is amplified. Conveniently, our gate driver chip has something called an enable pin, which is basically like its on-off switch. If we feed the interrupter signal to the enable pins, we can control the Tesla coil's pulse duration and frequency, and therefore the spark appearance. By the way, all this low voltage circuitry is powered by a few simple voltage regulators, which take any DC voltage from 14 to 24 volts and adjust it to fit the circuit's needs. The resulting interrupt signal from our driver circuit is finally sent to a small device known as a gate drive transformer, or GDT. The GDT can be easily made by wrapping two 12-turn coils and one 8-turn coil onto a suitable ferrite core. There are plenty of usable ferrite cores out there, but the ones I recommend are made of materials 77 and 75. I'm personally using a number 77 ferrite in my design. Once properly assembled, the GDT converts the single 12-volt signal from our driver into two 18-volt signals, which are optimal for switching our transistors. If we phase the GDT correctly, it will cause the transistors to switch the DC voltage from our power supply across the primary coil at the resonant frequency. And since the resonant frequency is detected by the drive circuit, we can stick basically any secondary coil in the primary coil's field and it will resonate almost perfectly, producing an extremely powerful electrical discharge.
Now, our circuit is designed to run off of 340 volts DC. However, most wall sockets tend to only output 120 volts AC, or 240 volts AC, depending on where you live. So, how do we get that kind of voltage? I'll let Clayton from the Plasma Prince explain.
Hey everyone, I'm the Plasma Prince, and I designed the doubler PCB. It's pretty simple. I mean, it's just your typical voltage doubler, but in 240 volt countries, it's just a full bridge rectifier. Or more commonly known as
full bridge rectifier.
The NTC thermistor will soft start the whole circuit, so current goes in a little bit slowly than it would without, and that's overall better for the circuit. Then it goes through the diodes and gets rectified, which converts 120 volts AC to 170 volts DC, half wave, that is. So the current almost behaves as if it's pulsated, and we don't really want that for the circuit. Plus, 170 volts DC isn't as great as what we could go to. So we have the big rectifying caps at the end that smooth out the current and also allow the voltage doubling phenomenon to take place. These big capacitors will charge in parallel and discharge in series, which allows the voltage to sum up to 340 volts DC, not half wave. And that's exactly what we want to drive the bridge.
Awesome. Now that we've covered the circuit's design layout, let's put it all together. Alright, this thing's looking pretty slick, but there are still a few final arrangements that need to be made before we can fire the circuit up. For one, we actually need the coils themselves.
Coil winding and setup can be a little confusing for some beginners, so I enlisted Nick from Coil Labs to help show how it's done.
When I want to build a Tesla coil, usually the first thing I do before I start building anything is I run some calculations that determine the approximate value of the important design parameters. First is usually the resonant frequency. Getting this in the right range depends on a lot of different factors, but for this coil, I needed to keep it under 400 kHz to work with this driver circuit, because that's the limitation of these transistors. The resonant frequency depends on the number of turns of the secondary, its height, its diameter, and the size of the top lobe. There are a bunch of guides online with equations for calculating all of this, and there are also useful programs that basically work as Tesla coil calculators that can do this for you, like Java TC. Once you get your secondary design, then you need to wind your coil. This is often a long and tedious process, especially if you're doing it by hand. Now, if you're a normal person like me and you don't have access to a big lathe, you can still speed up the process a lot just with some small motors and caster wheels. I usually use PVC pipes as the forms for my coils, but I've seen people use other things like acrylic tubes or even cardboard tubes. Don't use black PVC pipes, however. Those usually contain a lot of carbon, and they aren't as transparent to magnetic fields as normal PVC is. That'll cause a lot of unwanted energy losses and make your coil not work as well. The other important factor here is what we call coupling between the primary and secondary coils. For solid-state coils like this, as well as for vacuum tube coils, you typically want the coupling somewhere between 0.3 and 0.4. What that means is 30% or 40% of the magnetic flux generated by the primary goes through the cross-section of the secondary. Anyway, one of the really cool things about Tesla coils is while there are some general guidelines to follow, you really can experiment with these a lot and build them however you want. Some people even do really outlandish stuff like flat pancake secondary coils and things like that. Read up and make sure you know what you're doing so you stay safe, but have fun experimenting.
All right, we've now covered basically everything, but before we can give the circuit a run for its money, I have a few minor but very important things to go over. First, be sure to ground the negative rail of your drive circuit. Conveniently, my PCB takes care of this issue with its designated ground connection, which is pretty sweet. I also recommend shielding your circuit from interference by surrounding it with a layer of grounded metal or metal foil. Just be sure to leave the antenna exposed outside the box so the circuit can still resonate. Before I go any further, I'd like to give a huge shout out to Kyle Dewey's for making and sending me this beautiful custom-built circuit enclosure. He put a lot of time and effort into making this for me, and I'm super pleased with how it turned out. If you like what you see, go check out his channel, Dewey's Engineering and Restoration. He's pretty new to YouTube, so be sure to give him lots of love. Now, my next piece of advice is to not use magnet wire on your gate drive transformer. I know it's tempting, but when I tried it, the whole thing just sparked and shorted out. Thank God the circuit wasn't damaged. Finally, be sure to keep the primary impedance over 6 ohms. This may sound confusing, but it's actually quite simple. Just go to a website like this that shows how to calculate LC impedance and input your coil specifications. The inductance is that of your primary coil, and the frequency is just your secondary coil's natural resonant frequency. Both of these values can be calculated using our old friend, JavaTC. For the capacitance, you'll just use the value of one of your inverter capacitors. If you're following my schematic, this should be around 1 microfarad, although that's not super critical. Once you hit calculate, the value you're interested in is the one marked total LC impedance. Once again, make sure you're just over 6 ohms of impedance. If you go any lower, your transistors will likely suffer, and as you go higher, your sparks will get smaller. In general, 5 turns on the primary coil will give you a good result.
Alright, I've kept you waiting long enough. It's time to fire this thing up and see what it can really do. Alright, can you see why I love this thing? It is so much more powerful and versatile than the SSTC that we built in my last video.
This circuit can even hold its own against commercial DR SSTCs. When built right, this thing can produce sparks longer than some of the 1 Tesla coils, all while being at only a fraction of the cost and less electrically stressed than a DR SSTC. And unlike most dual resonant and spark gap Tesla coils, this SSTC circuit can drive almost any coil setup without hours of painstaking tuning. I didn't even have to get a scope to get this thing working on the first try.
Of course, there's probably still one feature you've been dying to see, the music mode.
On the PCB, I added a designated port to feed pulse DC signals into. If we switch off the interrupter and apply a 6 to 12 volt music signal, the coil comes to life and plays the desired tune.
Have I convinced you to make one of your own yet? If you would like to make your own copy of this circuit, I put everything you need down in the video description. I put the instructions, parts list, and even the Gerber files to print your own PCB copies.
To order your own PCBs, just go to your favorite PCB manufacturing site, I recommend JLCPCB, and submit the Gerber files I provided, and pay literally like $10. It's that simple. Heck, you can even pick your PCB color if you want.
We're nearing the end of the video, so you know what that means. It's giveaway time.
I have 8 PCBs left over for the new circuit, as well as 3 bonus PCBs made for the simple SSTC circuit from our last Tesla coil video. All you have to do to win one of these is like this video and post a comment with some indication of which PCB you'd be interested in receiving. I'll randomly pick the winners after a few weeks and reply to their comments notifying them that they won and give them details on how to contact me.
Be sure to check out all the other channels who were involved in this collaboration. They all spent countless hours trying to teach me about solid state technology, and for that I think they've totally earned your subscription.
Plasma Prints, Coil Labs, and Nerd Labs are all making videos about this circuit as well, so be sure to go check them out. Brian from Side2HD also has a few older videos detailing his endeavors with the Lonotion's SSTC2, so be sure to go check them out as well. And if you like awesome Tesla coil content, you should definitely take a look at Jerry's work at Archangel Tesla Coils. His coils dwarf mine by comparison, and he just completed one of his biggest coils yet, which he calls the Screaming Eagle. Of course, I can't leave out PowerMax and Magnet Assist, both of which have amazing, highly informal channels that specialize in high voltage mayhem.
As always, make sure to like, subscribe, and comment. It really helps this channel and encourages me to make more videos. If this video gets enough support, who knows? I might make a Dear SSTC for a 1,000 subscriber special. And after that, QCW and beyond. Anyway, that's all for now. LabCoatz, out.